Good day everyone. In this video, we shall discuss single phase hop bridge inverter operation and analysis under various load conditions. Contents that I am going to cover in this session are as follows. Firstly, we shall see the operation of single phase hop bridge inverter, followed by single phase hop bridge inverter analysis under resistive load condition, inductive load condition and RL load condition and RLC load condition respectively. So let us see the operation of single phase hop bridge inverter. We know circuit diagram of the single phase hop bridge inverter is as shown in this figure, right? We have two capacitors here on the DC link side. So we take this as source 1 and this is source 2, C1, and so it delivers power whenever the switch, the topmost switch is conducting. Similarly, so the C2 would recharge the energy during the conduction of the bottom switch, right? Now each switch, they have the they have transistor in anti-parallel with diode, right? So now let us see the operation. In order to explain the operation, I will assume the following. All switches are ideal. So switches, if you see, there are four switches, among which two are control switch. You can see S1 and S2. So these two are control switches, and diode 1 and diode 2 are uncontrolled switches, and they are ideal. So they are ideal, they are assumed to be ideal. That is assumption number 1. Assumption number 2 is that this circuit is operated in such a way that top switch, this top switch combination is conducting for 50% of the period and bottom switch is conducting for 50% of the period over complete switching cycle. So that is, so as shown in this particular graph, you can see that control signal for switch, top switch, you can see that is given for T/2 seconds, and then remaining T/2 seconds, so the control signal for the topmost switch is that is off, okay, that is the won't conduct. So this T/2 time, this interval, the voltage that appear across the load would be same as VDC/2. And for next off cycle, that is from T/2 to T, the bottom switch would conduct, during which the voltage across load would be -VS/2. This is the operation for complete switching cycle, and same thing would repeat for remaining cycles. Okay, we have shown only two cycles here, two switching cycles. Now you can see, so during the top switch conduction period, voltage across load is +VDC/2. During which S1 would conduct. Okay, when I say S1, it is not only the S1, diode also. So including diode, let me take it as Q1 otherwise. So this Q1 is combination of S1 and D1. So whenever this Q1 is conducting, voltage across load would be VDC/2. When Q2 is conducting, that is either S2 or D2, when any one of them are conducting, voltage across load would be minus VDC/2, where VDC is the actual input supply voltage. Okay. And now the mathematical expression for the output voltage V0, that is equal to VDC/2 for the half of the cycle. So that is omega t ranging from 0 to pi. And remaining half cycle, it is -VDC/2. That is from pi to 2 pi. Omega t ranging from pi to 2 pi, it is -VDC/2. And it repeats. It is periodic in nature. The voltage waveform across load is periodic in nature. That repeats for every 2 pi radians. Every 2 pi radians. Okay. Let us try to use this mathematical expression to find out Fourier series. We know this is the output voltage. And load is pure AC, so this is AC load. It require AC voltage to be appear across it. So where this voltage, the output voltage, is not perfect AC. So it will have the fundamental component. A is shown, I am showing here. So this is fundamental component. Apart from fundamental component, it also contain the harmonics, which are to be removed or to be eliminated, or at least to be minimized. So we want this kind of voltage that is shown with this red curve to be appear across the load. Remaining all are harmonics, so they have to be minimized or eliminated by using any filter kind of the components. Okay. Now anyway, let us see what are the different switching states. So when E switch is conducting, what would be the voltage and current? Now, so we know there are four sub switches. So let me say switch one, that is IGBT in the top. From the top group of switches is conducting. So during this period, current would flow this way. So the convention I am following for load voltage and load current polarity and direction respectively are as follows. So this way I take voltage across load with this polarity and I take current direction this way, that is right to left. Okay, this is the conventional direction I am considering. Now, when S1 is conducting, we can see that diode 1, S2 and D2, they are not going to conduct. We know for voltage source inverter, so this is voltage source inverter. So when top switch is conducting, bottom switch must be off. So you can see that bottom switch is not conducting here. In case both are conducting, that leads to dead short circuit, right? So please do remember that. Now let me assume that S1 is conducting. So when S1 is conducting, so this is the direction of the current. Current would flow this way. Now you can see that current direction is matching with the convention that I am following. So I0 can be taken as positive. And what about voltage? So applying KVL for this loop, you can see that voltage across load would be same as plus VDC by 2. So this is for the switching state 1 when S1 is conducting. Now the voltage across load is fixed, right? That is VDC by 2. But what about current? Current is greater than 0, and that depends on the type of the load. For example, if it is resistive load, so simply the current flowing for this switching state would be VDC by 2 by R. That is V0 by R simply. Okay. Now of course that depends on the load. Okay. And now similarly, so in case diode is conducting, the path of current would be this way. So we know diode must conduct in this direction only. Okay. So when diode 1 is conducting, applying KVL, you can find that voltage across load is same as plus VDC by 2. But what about current? So current is, you can see current direction is opposite to the direction I have given to the load current. So load current is negative. Load current is negative with respect to this particular direction. Right. So now third switching state, that is S2, that is IGBT in the bottom. So that is conducting. So current must flow in this direction, because the current that is allowed by the switch should be in this direction, right? So when current is flowing in this direction, you can see that current direction is opposite to the convention that I have the direction I have assigned for the load current. So I0 is going to be negative. So when this S2 is conducting, and what about the load voltage? Load voltage is equal to minus VDC by 2. Load voltage equal to minus VDC by 2 for this switching state, that is when S2 is conducting. Now similarly, when D2 is conducting, the last switching state, that is when D2 is conducting. So when D2 is conducting, you can see that current through diode must flow in this direction. So current must flow when diode is conducting, current through load must flow in this direction. And this current direction is in agreement with the direction that I have assigned to the load current. So I0 is positive. And what about V0? Applying KVL for this loop, you can find that V0 is equal to minus VDC by 2. So this way, corresponding to each switching state, we can find out the voltage across the load and current direction. Right? So this is the operation of single phase off bridge inverter. Now let us see the steady state analysis. So let me take let me consider load is general load, that can be any other let me take generalized case, that can be R load, RL load, RLC load, any kind of load. So now for any kind of load, we know that the output voltage is equal to VDC by 2 for 50% of the cycle, switching cycle, and that is equal to minus VDC by 2 for remaining 50% of the switching cycle, right? That is for switching period. Now the RMS value, if you find out RMS value for the output voltage, you can see that that value is equal to VDC by 2. That value is equal to VDC by 2, and you can also find out Fourier series, and from Fourier series you can find out what is the fundamental component and what are the remaining components. But if you observe carefully, you can see that this contain only hard harmonics because the signal is symmetric. Okay, this is going to be odd symmetrics and it is half wave symmetric. It contain only hard harmonics, and that too sine terms only sine terms. Okay, you can find out Fourier series. So once you find out Fourier series, you can see the contribution of each harmonic, and we know that fundamental component must contribute to the load power, and remaining components that are harmonics are unwanted. They have to be eliminated. They leads to deterioration in the performance of the load as well as the power tonic converter. Okay, efficiency will be reduced. So you must eliminate or you must minimize the harmonics, and you must ensure that the fundamental component is only contributing to the performance of the load, right? Okay, so anyway, so the RMS value of output voltage is equal to, that is VOR equal to VDC by 2. Fourier series expansion of output voltage, please recall my lecture on Fourier series computation. So please go through this, go through that lecture, and you will see you, and if you once you understand that lecture, I hope you can compute Fourier series directly. And for this particular waveform, Fourier series would contain only hard harmonics, and so fundamental component, third harmonic, fifth harmonic, and seventh harmonic, and so on. Fundamental component would be 2 VDC by pi into sine omega t, where omega is the fundamental frequency in radians per second. So once you know the switching period or switching frequency, you can find out what is this omega. And VDC is given to us, right? VDC is the source voltage. Similarly, third harmonic, fifth harmonic, you can find out them. So in short, you can also express the output voltage Fourier series in this fashion. Okay, it contain only hard harmonic. You can see it contain only hard harmonic. Simply, the nth order harmonic can be computed by using this particular expression. So that is 2 VDC by n pi into sine n omega t. So this is the mathematical expression for the nth harmonic component in the output voltage. Now, RMS value of the fundamental and nth order harmonic voltage, you can find out this way. So simply, so this 2 VDC by n pi, 2 VDC by n pi is the peak value of nth harmonic. And if you want to find out RMS value, you have to divide it by root 2, right? For any sinusoidal voltage or sinusoidal waveform, we know RMS value would be peak value by root 2. So by root 2, so you get this. So V0, we know the peak value of the fundamental component equal to 2 VDC by 2. So divided by root 2, so that is equal to root 2 VDC by pi. So this is the fundamental component of the output voltage. So if you want to find out RMS value, this is RMS value of nth harmonic. So you can find out this way. So simply, this is peak value by root 2. So that is root 2 VDC by n pi. So this way you can find out the Fourier series RMS value of output voltage, RMS value of nth order harmonic, and so on. And these three expressions are independent of type of the load. Okay, please remember that output voltage depends on the switching action. Okay, that depends on the switching state. That does not depend on the load. Independent of load, which switch is conducting. So from that you can find out what is the output voltage. That is independent of load. So these all three expressions are independent of loop. Okay. Now the next one, the current expression. So Fourier series for the current output current expression. So we know the output voltage contain the several harmonics, especially even odd order harmonics, right? And once you know each harmonic component, you can find out what is the harmonic component present in the current also. Now that this is expression, so I naught is equal to I naught, so that is output current is equal to I naught is equal to fundamental component plus third order harmonic plus fifth order harmonic plus seventh order harmonic and so on. So it contains only odd order harmonics. Okay, so based on the load condition, so we can find out the each of these components. For example, I would like to find out fundamental component. So simply fundamental voltage by the impedance offered to the fundamental voltage. So that from that equation you can find out what is the fundamental component of the current. Similarly, third order harmonic you can find out that way. So we know for each order harmonic, so we know if you know the impedance offered, so impedance offered is magnitude and phase angle. From that you can find out, you can see, so 2 VDC by pi is the peak value of the fundamental voltage by Z1. So what is this? This is the impedance offered to the fundamental component. And here what is pi? So pi is the phase angle of the impedance for the fundamental component. So that is the fundamental frequency. So we know the impedance depends on the frequency, right? So resistance, okay, but for inductance, in case load contain inductance or capacitance, the impedance value depends on the frequency. For first order harmonic, fundamental component, frequency is omega. So by substituting omega in the impedance value of offered by inductance and capacitance, you can find out what is the Z1. Similarly, for third order harmonic, the frequency is 3 omega. Okay, so corresponding impedance can be find out. And from that you can find out the mathematical expression for the third order harmonic that is present in the load current. Similarly, fifth order harmonic and so on. So in short, you can write this way. So I naught is equal to sigma n, where n is equal to 1, 3, 5 and so on up to infinity into 2 VDC by n pi. What is this 2 VDC by n pi? This is peak value. So peak value by the impedance offered by the load for nth order component corresponding to n omega frequency into sine n omega t minus pi n. What is pi n? This is the angle, impedance angle of the impedance offered by the load for nth order harmonic. Now the RMS value of fundamental and nth order harmonic current. So once you know this mathematical expression, from that you can find out. We know the RMS values or the peak values by root 2 for sine component. So do that, you get root 2 VDC by pi into Z1 is the RMS value of fundamental component. Similarly, nth order harmonic RMS value, that is root 2 VDC by n pi into Zn. Okay. Yeah. Now coming to the next one, fundamental displacement factor. Okay, so we have seen what is fundamental displacement factor in case of the rectifier. So similarly, this case also you can find out. Okay, it is simply the phase angle difference between the fundamental component of the voltage across the load and the fundamental component of the current, load current. The phase angle difference between fundamental component of the voltage and current across the load is, once that is known, so cosine of that angle would be fundamental displacement factor. Now what is phi 1? This is phase angle difference between fundamental voltage and fundamental current across the load. Power absorbed by the load due to only fundamental component. So this is of our interest because we want only fundamental component to be responsible to operate the load. Remaining R is to be eliminated. So it is important to know power absorbed by load due to only fundamental component. Okay. So that you can do, that is equal to P01, which is equal to V1 into I1 into cos pi 1. Right. V1 is equal to RMS value of the fundamental voltage. I1 is RMS value of fundamental current. across the through the load, and cosine of angle between this V1 and I1, that is fundamental voltage and fundamental current across the load. So if they are known to us, you can find out what is the power absorbed by load due to only fundamental component. So this is very, very important, right? And the next one, the power absorbed by load due to ease source. So I told you, in half wave half bridge inverter, we have the capacitor, two capacitor in the DC link side, right? So each C1 and C2, and both you can take each of them as a separate source. So then you can find out what is the power absorbed due to each source. So power absorbed by power delivered by each source, or power absorbed by load due to each source, that is equal to, so we know for DC, the each source input side, they are DC, so power is equal to voltage across the source into average value of current through the source. So that is equal to VDC by 2 into average value of source 1 current. So, and we know the operation is more or less symmetric. So power delivered by source 1 must be equal to power delivered by source 2. Okay. So this way, so if you find out power delivered by one source, so that is, so same power would be delivered by the other source. Now the next important factor should be known to us is the total power absorbed by the load. So this is, if you see, so this is the seventh point. So P01, this indicate power absorbed by load due to only fundamental component. So what is the total power absorbed? That is power absorbed due to all components including harmonics. So how can you find out? There are two ways. Because we assume that all switches are ideal, so switching losses or other losses are zero, the power delivered by source is equal to the power absorbed by load. So you can total power absorbed by load is same as power delivered by the source. Now there are two sources, input side, so power absorbed by each source, so add them together, so P naught is equal to 2 into P into source 1. So this is the power absorbed by the load, which is same as power delivered by the source. Both are equal. So this way you can find out, or else you can also find out using this formula. Instead of finding from the input side, you can find out from load side. So we know the fundamental, for example, we know the fundamental voltage and fundamental current, second, third order harmonic. I mean, if you know the Fourier series expression for the output voltage and current, so you can find out power absorbed by the load due to each component. So now if you see, this is the power absorbed by load due to only fundamental component, and this is power absorbed by the load due to third order harmonic, and coming to this, this is due to fifth harmonic, and so on. So this is the another expression. Or else we know in the load only resistor is responsible for power absorption. So power taken by only resistive load, and remaining portion of load, for example it is RL load, RLC load, so L and C component are not going to take any power, so only resistor would take power. In case if you know I01, I03, I05, that are the fundamental current, third harmonic current, fifth harmonic current, and so on, and if you know low resistance, so simply you can find out power absorbed by resistor present in the load due to each component using this formula. So that is current through load square into resistance value. So due to each component you can find out, and if you take that, and in this particular formula you can take R common. If you take R common, it is equal to I01 square plus I03 square plus I05 square, and so on. So what is this? So this is, if you see, so this is the RMS value of the load current, simply speaking. So what is this? This is RMS value of load current square. So it is square of the RMS value of load current. So that is what I substitute here. So simply, if you know the RMS value of the load current, total load current due to all components including harmonics, so simply that RMS value square into resistance value gives us the power absorbed by the load. Okay, so power delivered by source is same as power absorbed by load, so both are equal. Now the next important the parameters which are need to be computed is more of an hour, conduction angle of each switch and diode. That depends on the type of the load. Okay, we shall see later on. and average switching current and diode current. What is the average value of current through switch and diode? They are also important in order to select the proper switch and diode. Then the voltage rating of each switch is also very, very important. It is very, very important. So that is equal to VDC. We know from realization of the circuit itself that each switch must black VDC, right? That is same as the source voltage. So that is equal to VDC, which is equal to 2 times of VDC by 2. We know the power delivered to the load at VDC by 2 voltage, right? So that value into 2. So the rating is double to, that is twice to the voltage it can deliver, the converter inverter can deliver. So this is one of the drawback. Okay, so this is one of the drawback. We will see that in case of full bridge converter, full bridge inverter, the voltage rating is same as the voltage it can deliver. So relatively this is one of the disadvantages with the single phase or bridge inverter. Next one, average source current. So that depends on type of the loop. Okay, so now this is about the steady state analysis of single phase or bridge inverter for any kind of loop, any kind of loop. Now let us see what would be the steady state analysis for each load. So I will take R load, RL load, RLC load and so on. So now firstly let me take R load. So we know as long as switch 1 is conducting, that is top switch is conducting, voltage across load is same as VDC by 2, and as long as it is VDC by 2, current through load would be same as VDC by 2, VDC by 2 by R in this direction. We know for resistor always current would be in agreement or in phase with the voltage. So it would be, it follow the similar shape. You can see the current also going to follow this kind of shape, same shape. So we know according to formula, I naught is equal to V naught by R. Similarly, when the bottom switch is conducting, that is this switch is conducting, that is for the second off cycle, that is negative off cycle, voltage across load would be negative and current also going to be negative. So that is during this way. Okay. So we know, once you know the current waveform, from current waveform you can find out which of the switch is going to conduct. Is it going to be Q1 or D1 from top switch is conducting for each period. Similarly, from this bottom, which of the switch is going to conduct? Is it going to be Q2 or D2? So that depends on the load. Now you can see here the voltage is positive. So the switch corresponding to top leg, so this top portion of the leg must be conducting. In case current is positive, Q1 should conduct. In case current is negative, D1 should conduct. Right? Similarly, so in bottom switch, so when bottom switch is conducting, either Q2 or D2 is conducting, voltage would be negative. So when voltage is negative and if current is positive, which should conduct, which of these two should conduct, Q2 or D2? So it is D2, right? So if D2 is conducting, current should be in agreement with the load current direction as shown in the figure. So D2, when D2 is conducting, so load voltage and load current are going to be in phase, right? In case the Q2 is conducting, what would happen? So in this case, current is negative, during the negative off cycle, that is from T by T to T, so Q2 must conduct. In case current is also positive, that is in the direction as shown in this particular figure, that is with this direction, then D2 must conduct. Now according to the current wave shape, you can see that for first off period, that is from 0 to T by 2, so Q1 must be on. Similarly for second half cycle, Q2 must be on. Okay, and this is about the current wave shape. So I have considered current and voltage wave shape for only one cycle. Now what about switch current, what about the source current? So source one current would flow only when top switch is conducting, when Q1 is conducting. So that is same as this. And when Q2 is conducting, so there would be no current flowing from source one, that is this capacitor. Okay, that is shown here. That is what's shown here. So if I consider complete cycle, only for 50% of the cycle, the source would conduct, which is same as the switch current, that is Q1 current. Now diode won't conduct for resistive load. Diode won't conduct. You can see for 50% of the time period, Q1 on. For remaining 50% of the switching cycle, Q2 is on. So there is no question of diode conducting. So diode won't conduct. Diode won't conduct. Okay. Now for this particular load condition, we know that VOR is same as VDC by 2. It is independent of the load condition. And what about IOR? IOR is equal to VDC by 2R. You can compute. We know I0 is equal to V0 by R. No, I0 is equal to V0 by R. So, substitute that. So from this expression, we know I0 is proportional to V0. So IOR is going to be VOR by R, where VOR equal to VDC by 2. So directly we would get this. Now similarly, switch current is same as the source current. Now for example, here switch Q1 current is same as the source 1 current, and switch Q2 current is same as source 2 current. So that is what is mentioned here. Source current is same as switch current. Now if one want to know what is the average value of source current, yes, you can find out. So this is the source current. No, only 50% of the period we are going to have the current flowing through the source or switch, and the conduction angle is going to be 180. So you can see that Q1 and Q2 both are going to be conducting for 180 degrees and 180 degrees respectively for complete 360 degrees cycle. So if I consider this, if I consider the switching period in degrees, so 360 is degrees is corresponding to one switching cycle. So each switch would conduct for 180 degrees. That is what is mentioned here. Now average value of switch current is VDC by 4R, which is same as IQ1 average. And what about the diode current? Diode won't conduct. So conduction period of diode is zero. Diode current is equal to zero. Right. So conduction angle of each transistor is equal to 180 degrees or pi radians. Conduction angle of each diode is equal to 0 degrees. Okay, this is also very, very important. Sometimes you may be asked to find out the conduction angle of diode or transistor. Okay, now coming to the analysis. So what to do? So you have to, in order to analyze the operation, so you must consider the Fourier series expansion for output voltage and output current. So we know, we have discussed earlier. So this is the Fourier series expansion for output voltage, and for output current, so Fourier series expansion would be this way. So simply, you are going to have the you must divide. So this Fourier series, this nth order component by its impedance. Okay, that is what I am doing. So for resistive load, impedance is independent of frequency. So I have taken it as ZR all the time. So this is Fourier series expansion. Now fundamental component, its peak value. So you know fundamental component of the voltage would be this. So that is 2 VDC by pi into sin omega t. Its RMS value is equal to root 2 VDC by pi. That is peak value by root 2. Similarly, I01, that is equal to 2 VDC by pi R, and its corresponding RMS value root 2 into VDC by pi R. So this is the RMS value of fundamental component. And power absorbed by the load due to fundamental component alone, so we know it is resistive load, so for which the phase angle difference between load voltage and load current fundamental components are going to be zero. So in that case, cos pi 1, so this displacement factor would be equal to 1. So power absorbed by load due to fundamental component V01 into I01, that is equal to V01 into I01 only, where these are the RMS value of fundamental voltage and RMS value of fundamental current respectively. And if somebody wants to know what is power absorbed by load due to each source or power delivered by each source, so that is equal to the voltage across, because input side we have DC voltage source. So voltage across the source into average value of current through that would give us the power delivered by each source. So So power voltage across each source is VDC by 2, and I source, the current delivered by each source, the average value is equal to VDC by 2 into R. So substitute that value is equal to VDC square by 8 into R. Now total power observed, so we know total power observed is equal to power delivered by each source, sum to each source, you have to add them together, and if I add them together, you will get that is equal to 2 into PS1. So 2 times, there are 2 sources, 2 into PS1, PS1 is the power delivered by each source. Or we can also use this formula. If you know the RMS value of current flowing through load and resistance offered by the load, so simply RMS value of current through load square into resistance value give us the power of the load directly, right? So this way one can do the analysis for single phase half bridge inverter with R load. Now next case, the L load, single phase half bridge inverter with L load. Okay, so now consider consider single phase half bridge inverter and assume that load is purely inductive in nature. We know the mathematical expression for the output voltage, we know for 50% of time it is VDC by 2, and for remaining 50% of time it is equal to minus VDC by 2 when I consider one switching period, right? So I have considered only one switching period. And we know this is inductive in nature, assuming that initial current through inductance is zero and load is purely inductance. So we know that because voltage across inductance is completely DC, it is constant value. So current through that would rise linearly with the slope that is equal to this voltage by L, right? So what is this voltage? It is VDC by 2. So VDC by 2 L is the slope of the voltage current flowing through the load during this period, that is 0 to T by 2. Now exactly in the middle, so assuming that initial load current is 0, initial current through load is 0, so you can see that it starts at some value, let me take it as minus IP, peak value of load current, and it will rise gradually exactly at T by 4. That is after quarter cycle, it will become zero. Later it increases further, it increases to peak value at T by 2. So as long as there is a positive voltage appear, so current will rise, and current will reach its peak value at this instant. Now from this instant onwards, what is happening actually? Load voltage is becoming negative. Load voltage is becoming negative, so current would fall with the negative slope. And what is the slope? That is equal to voltage appear across the load divided by L, where L is the inductance suffered by the load. So minus VDC by 2 L. So this way it is going to fall, right? Now if you let me consider each quarter cycle. Now you can see in the first quarter cycle, voltage is positive, load voltage is positive, but load current is negative. So load voltage is positive, load current is negative. So this is possible if and only if diode is conducting, diode 1 is conducting. So D1 is on during this quarter cycle. And for next quarter cycle, so we can see that voltage and current both are positive across the load. So this is possible if and only if Q1 is conducting, that is transistor is conducting, so the switch is conducting. Now at T by 2, from T by 2 onwards, T by 2 to 3 T by 4, so that is for next quarter cycle, you can see that voltage is negative and current is positive. So that is possible if and only if this D2 is conducting, the diode 2 is conducting. So that is what is mentioned here, D2 is on. Similarly, for next quarter cycle, that is last quarter cycle of one switching period, you can see that voltage is negative and current negative. This is possible if and only if this Q2 is on. So if and only if this Q2 is on. Okay. So this way we are going to have this kind of triangular current flowing through the load in case the load is purely inductive in nature. Right. So now how to find out this peak value? So IP or minus IP, how can you find out? So we know slope is VDC by 2L. And what about this period? This period is equal to T by 4. So now simply this is a straight line. So for this straight line, you can, we know Y is equal to MX, right? So using that particular thing, so we can, you can find out what is the peak value. So this is the slope and this is the height. And what about this base? So this base is equal to t by 4. So VDC by 2L into t by 4 would be the peak value of current flowing through the inductor. And what about minus IP? That is negative peak, that is minus VDC by 2L into t by 4. So this would be the case if and only if inductor is initially not charged, not energized. Initial current to inductor is 0. Now, what about the peak value? What about the RMS value of current flowing through the load? So we know for this angular kind of wave shape, you can find out RMS value. RMS value would be IP by square root 3. Right? I hope you know how to compute this. So please do it. Please verify this. IP by root 3 is the RMS value of current flowing through the load. Now, what is the source current? So source 1 current is going to flow during the positive half cycle. So that is during this period, right? During the first half cycle, that is positive half cycle of the voltage, current flowing through the load is same as current flowing through the source. That is what indicated here. So that is what is indicated here, okay? You can note that here, right? Similarly, the source, the Q1 current through Q1 would be same as this current, right? So the positive current that is flowing through the second quarter cycle. So this is same as what? The current through the switch. And what about this? So this is same as current through the diode D1. That is what is indicated here. So now once you know the current through switches, current through source and all that, once you know their waveform, you can find out their mathematical expression, and then you can find out what are their average values or RMS values respectively for throughout complete cycle. Now you can find out average value of source 1 current would be 0. The area under curve is 0, so this average value would be 0. That is source average current is 0. Because source average current is 0, what is the power delivered by the source? So power delivered by source, because source side we have DC source, so DC voltage across the source into the average value of current through the source. So average value of current through source is 0, so multiplication product of both of them is 0. So there would be no current, no power delivered by the source. We know inductance, pure inductance cannot take any power, okay? It cannot absorb the power. So that is what is we are obtaining from this also. So average value of source current is 0. So from this you can verify that fact. Average value of the switch current, average value of diode current, you can find out once you can draw this. So I strongly recommend you to do it, and if you do this, you will get that value is equal to IP by 8, peak value by 8 and peak value by 8, where peak value is equal to VDC by 2L into T by 4. From that you can find out average value of the switch current and diode current respectively. Now when I say switch, so I take this as a switch. So generally in inverter analysis, so this is switch, which is usually transistor, and diode we call it as diode. Okay. So when I refer to switch, that is refer to this particular Q1 or Q2. So here switch means Q1 or Q2. Of course we will mention what is that. So Q1 or Q2, that has to be mentioned. Now anyway, what is the conduction angle of the switch and diode? So each switch would conduct for 90 degrees or pi by 2 radians, and each diode would conduct for 90 degrees. So this is the case for inductive load, pure inductive load. And coming to the analysis. So we know 4S is expansion for output voltage and output current, or as follows. So we know this is already, this expression already, we have seen several times, right? And coming to the current expression, so here you have to divide this expression by the impedance offered for each harmonic component. We know for nth order harmonic, the impedance offered by the inductance is equal to, okay? So that is equal to, n into omega L, right? J n into omega L, n, so frequency is n omega into L is the magnitude of impedance, and J n omega L, the impedance phase angle would be 90 degrees. So because it is inductance, so any harmonic component current will lag corresponding voltage by 90 degrees. That is what is mentioned here. This is a mathematical expression for the output current. Coming to the fundamental component of output voltage and current, so from this you know the peak values. So peak value by root 2, you are going to you can get the RMS value of the fundamental voltage and fundamental current respectively. Coming to power absorbed by load due to fundamental component, we know the phase angle difference between the fundamental voltage and current is 90 degrees. There won't be any power taken by the load due to fundamental component. In fact, there is no power taken by the load from any other component also. So the power absorbed by load due to each source as well as total power absorbed by load, both are going to be zero. There is no power absorbed by the load, right? And now coming to the next case, which is very, very popular. In fact, in general, loads are inductive in nature, so they would have a resistor and inductor. So this is the common load which we are going to encounter, right? So now in this case, again, let us consider this inverter circuit diagram. So this is inverter circuit diagram, and we know VDC by 2 is the voltage for first half cycle, and for next half cycle it is minus VDC by 2, assuming that this switch, top switch and bottom switch, are conducting for T by 2 and T by 2 seconds respectively, where T is the total switching period to complete one cycle. Now we know as long as the voltage across load is positive, current through load would increase in this fashion exponentially. We know for RL load it increases exponentially, and how fast it is going to increase or decrease, that depends on the load inductance value. Okay, if inductance is high, then it increases very, very slowly, gradually and slowly. In case inductive property is less, then it increase rapidly. Okay, now anyway, so you are going to have this kind of the current wave shape. You can see the behavior of the load current. Okay, load current wave shape is intermediate between R load and L load. We know for R load the voltage and current are going to have similar kind of wave shape. For L load, we are going to have triangular kind of current flowing through the load, and we know that current is going to lag voltage by 90 degrees. But here you can see it is going to increase exponentially, and you can also see that it lags the current fundamental. If I consider fundamental component of the voltage, the fundamental current is going to lag. Okay, fundamental current is going to lag the voltage, fundamental voltage, by some angle, where that angle ranging between 0 and 90. The behavior is intermediate between R load behavior and L load behavior, right? And we know, so whenever voltage is positive and current is negative, D1 is going to on, and when both are positive, Q1 is on. Similarly, when voltage is negative and current is positive, D2 on, and when voltage and current both are negative, so Q2 is on, where Q1 and Q2 are the switches and D1 and D2 are diode, right? And similarly, so once you know this phase angle, phase angle displacement, you can find out, you can sketch the current, source current wave shape, the switch current wave shape, and diode current wave shape. Okay, so this way you can do, and once you know the phase angle difference, the fundamental displacement angle, so from that you can find out what is the angle, conduction angle of each switch. So that is equal to 180 minus pi, and similarly conduction angle of diode, that is equal to pi 1, in fact. Okay, that is same as the pi 1, that is same as the displacement factor for fundamental component. Or else simply you can see this is, if you know this angle, from the directly you can find out what is the conduction angle of each diode. Coming to for the analysis, yeah, so similar way you can do. V naught expression would be similar to that of the previous case, and coming to I naught expression, so in place of Zn, So expression would be similar, but in case of this j, in case of this so zn and pi n can be calculated using this formula. For RL load, zn is equal to r square plus n omega l square square root. What is this n omega l? This is the impedance offered by inductance for nth order harmonic. Pi n is equal to tan inverse n omega by l. So fundamental component of the output voltage and current, again, so once you know this Fourier series expansion, from them you can find out, and you can also compute the RMS values, right? Power absorbed by load due to fundamental component, yeah, so if you know the RMS value of fundamental voltage and fundamental current and fundamental displacement factor, you can find out that. Or else if you know the fundamental current flowing through the load, so IO, that value square into resistance offered by the load, so would also give us the power absorbed by load due to fundamental component. Power absorbed by load due to each source, again, so we know the formula is similar, so that is VDC by 2 into the average value of the source current. For example, if you want to find out total power absorbed by the load, so that is equal to, so there are two ways to find out. So one is from the output side, other one is from input side. From input side, so it is equal to 2 into the power delivered by each source. From output side, it is equal to the power absorbed by the load due to each harmonic component, right? This also can be written this way, so that is IOR square into R, where IOR is the RMS value of the load current, where R is the load resistance that is present in the load. So this is about the bridge inverter operation with the operation and analysis with the RL load. Now the last one, that is RLC load. For example, let me take the load is RLC kind of load. So I would take the fundamental component of current only, so as to analyze the performance. We know as long as the top switch is conducting, voltage is VDC by 2, and when bottom switch is conducting, it is minus VDC by 2, right? And it would repeat. So this is the waveform. Now in case load is inductive in nature, for example, so it is RLC in case of inductance is more dominant compared to the capacitance, in that case what would happen? So fundamental current would lag the voltage, fundamental voltage, by some angle. So this is corresponding to inductive behavior. So you can see that XL is greater than XC, assuming that it is series RLC kind of load. Okay. So in this case, it is known as overdamped load kind of the response. And similarly, in case the behavior of load for fundamental component is capacitive in nature, then current will lead the voltage by some angle, so that is pi. Of course, this pi angle, pi, can be obtained from the impedance offered by the load due to fundamental component, right? So this way you can find out. Okay, so Q1, and we know whenever voltage and current both are positive, Q1 on; when both are negative, Q2 on; when voltage positive and current negative, D1 on; when voltage negative and current positive, D2 on, and so on, right? So that is what is mentioned here for each case 1 inductive nature, case 2 capacitive nature. Now in capacitive nature, it is underdamped in nature. You can see the load is underdamped in nature. So whenever it is underdamped in nature, we can see that once current becomes zero, so later we have some time for switches, so these switches to turn off, right? So we know usually Q1 and Q2 are transistors, but in olden days in inverters also SCRs were used, and SCRs are semi-control switches. So if you want to turn off that switch, you should make the current zero first, and then you have to apply reverse voltage. Now in case it is overdamped, you can see current is positive, voltage made negative, right? And later on, what is happening actually, so voltage and current both are going to be negative. So there is no time given for the switch to this switch Q1 or Q2 to turn off. Now in second case, in underdamped case, so after this current made zero, so we have some time. So we have some time during which we are applying reverse voltage. So because during this period, no, D1 is on. So you can see during this period D1 is on. When D1 is on, reverse voltage would appear across the switch, right? So that is possible only for underdamped case. In overdamped case, there is no possibility of applying reverse voltage. So there is no natural commutation that is possible. So in voltage source inverter case, especially in case load is capacitive nature or load is underdamped in nature, there is a possibility of natural commutation. Okay, in case if it is overdamped or inductive nature for fundamental component, so then there is no possibility of that natural commutation. Okay, after current throw switch made zero, that is Q1 or Q2 made zero, there is no natural process of applying reverse voltage. We have to go for force commutation. So in case if it is underdamped, there is a possibility that you can avoid this force commutation. You can go for natural commutation so that there is no complex circuitry is required to control the switching, right? So now what is circuit turn off time? Circuit turn off time is, so this period, the period during which the negative voltage is applied once current throw switch is made zero. So if you know that angle by the fundamental frequency would be the circuit turn off time, that is time given by the circuit for switch to turn off. So please do remember this. In case load is underdamped in nature, there is a possibility of occurrence of natural commutation even for inverter case. Usually for phase control rectifiers, there is a possibility of natural commutation. Inverters, there is no possibility except this particular case, right? And coming to analysis, yeah, so similar to the previous cases, you can do. So you can find out what is the Fourier series expansion for the output voltage, output current, and then you can find out the fundamental voltage and current and the respect to the RMS values, power observed by load due to fundamental component, power observed by load due to each source, power observed by the load, total power observed by the load, and so on. Okay. So this is about the single phase hall bridge inverter under various load condition. In next lecture we shall discuss the single phase full bridge inverter under various load conditions. Okay, thank you. I please solve as many problems as possible, and let me know if you have any doubts. Okay, you can reach me through the mail that is given in the description. Thank you.